Hello there, very good morning. So Helium One Global's David Minchin is joining us today because your exploration efforts in Tanzania, they've been backed up by a study at the University of Oxford and Durham University, which integrated data from last year's programme at the Rukwa project. So this is an academic study. It's been entitled The Principles of Helium Exploration. So David, what exactly are they saying?
Yeah, hi, Katie. Yeah, it was a great pleasure to see the publication on the principles of helium exploration in a Petroleum Geoscience in the February edition. It's great for a company like us to have institutions with the status and history of the University of Oxford and Durham University lending their support to our exploration thesis. We've been working with Oxford and Durham since 2016, funding sampling trips and providing access to our data, etc. We've been saying since last year that we've identified all of the components of a working helium system. It's very satisfying to see through independent research for Oxford University and Durham University are both saying the same things about us, that we've got all the systems of a working helium and have all the prerequisites for an economic helium resource.
And let's talk about sort of the system size as a whole. So we're talking about 700,000 billion cubic feet or so, right?
Yes, that's right. So the researchers calculated the total amount of helium generated within the Tanzanian craton and the associated mobile belts. And they worked out that roughly 700,000 billion cubic feet has been generated. Wow. Now, that is an astronomical number. I mean, we're exploring for a resource size of 138 billion cubic feet. So what they're saying is that although most of that helium generated over the last 2.5 billion years isn't going to be released, and most of the released helium will have been lost to the atmosphere. However, even so, the size of a system implies that even with inefficient release, migration and trapping, the regions can provide a huge high-grade, high helium concentration reservoirs. We're looking for 138 billion cubic feet. Which is a fraction of the amount which has been generated. And we're already seeing evidence of a system that doesn't have to be efficient to be working, because we saw evidence in when we drilled Thai of helium shows beneath quite inefficient seals, the base of the lake beds and in the red sandstones, which are pointing towards an active system and a working system of this large scale.
I mean, 700,000 billion cubic feet is quite mind-boggling, isn't it?
It's absolutely, it's a strategic scale, and that's something which the researchers point to is that the project can be strategic. And they say there's two real reasons why it's strategic. The first is that they point out is that the system is essentially free of greenhouse gases. So whereas all other helium systems around the world contain a portion of hydrocarbon, which dilutes the helium gases, and you result with systems which are majority hydrocarbon with less than 0.5% of helium, and are still considered highly economic. In the East African Rift, in the Tanzania, and in the Rukwa Basin, we're identifying a system with high-grade primary helium, 10.5%, up to 10.5% helium measured at surface in a nitrogen carrier gas. This is strategic now, it's going to become increasingly strategic as we transition into a green economy and wean ourselves off the hydrocarbon, which has been the morphine in our economic system for the last 100 years. And transition towards something which is a more sustainable future. We're still going to need our helium, and Helium One is uniquely positioned to be able to provide that through our primary green helium. The other strategic feature of Helium One is the size of the resource, which, as the researchers point out, it could represent about 25% of the current global helium reserve. This is especially important given the current geopolitical situation with the conflict between Russia and the Ukraine. When I was in Houston in December at the Gas World Conference, we spoke to several of the industrial majors who distribute helium gas around the globe. And the consensus of the conference is that these majors are depending on additional supply from the Amur plant in Russia to get them out of a looming supply shortage. This additional supply from Amur was already put into question when the plant caught fire and exploded in January, and substantial damage was caused, which was going to take approximately 12 months to repair. With the sanctions applied to Russia, it now seems less likely than ever that new supply is going to come on stream, which means that we are essentially facing a major long-term helium supply shortage. And the industrial companies, they're aware of that shortfall that they're facing. In this geopolitical situation, a new source of primary helium, which isn't aligned to any of the major powers, is essential to dig the big companies out of the situation which they're in. So when you combine the size of the project, the size of the resource, the size of the system, with the fact that it's a green, clean source of helium, it really points towards Helium One as a strategic asset for the supply of helium into the 21st century.
All right. David Minchin, thank you so much indeed from Helium One Global, talking about that study at the University of Oxford and Durham University, really sort of talking about your exploration efforts there in Tanzania and the strategic part of your operation as well. David, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Katie. It's been an absolute pleasure to talk to you.